Hey everyone, I'm Black Lightning. Race Realism Debunked once more. This is a shortened version of my Race Realism Debunked video. I'm only including my main arguments. I'm making it less ranty, and I'm going to get straight to the point. So let's get right into it. Since we don't have conclusive data for this topic, I can't say they are wrong with absolute certainty. If anything, I could debunk their conclusions. It's based on misinterpreted and flawed sources. This doesn't mean I believe everything is caused by the environment, because I have a reason to believe we're not born as blank slates. I believe we're born with certain character traits, but the environment, learning, and social experiences will shape us further. So it's a mix of genetic and environmental influences. How much each influence a trait depends on the trait being considered. So race is real. It's a social construct based on the observable genetic diversity within humanity. It has biological references despite the term race being constructed socially. These differences within humanity include phenotypic markers such as skin color and facial structure, to our genotypes such as different susceptibility to diseases. However, no matter how you choose to define a race, the differences within humanity today have not been proven to warrant a scientific classification or taxonomic status. You can make a category based on our differences on the genetic and phenotypic level for research purposes, but it doesn't make it a scientific classification. We are all Homo sapiens sapien. Homo sapiens are a relatively young species and has not had as much time to accumulate genetic variation, unlike the vast majority of species on Earth, most of which predate humans by enormous expanses of time. Most of the genetic differences are single nucleotide polymorphisms, which are single base pair differences. 15% of variation exists between populations, and 85% of variation exists within human populations. We share that 85%, and the 15% are mostly single nucleotide polymorphisms. That's why we look different and have different susceptibility to certain diseases. Some race realists will say that other species created subspecies in less than 100,000 years, so this means there should be subspecies within the human race today. Other species have a faster sexual maturity rate than humans. Humans mature slower and thus will need a much longer time before we see a new subspecies branching off. These other species will be able to create more generations than we can, and thus natural selection will be faster amongst them. I'll use an extreme example from the other side of the spectrum. Bacteria reproduces exponentially, becoming 2, then 4, then 8, doubling in 4 to 20 minutes under the right conditions. Because of this fast reproduction, bacteria can reproduce generations of bacteria that are immune to certain antibiotics because natural selection will be faster amongst them. We usually wait much longer before mating, and this will result in natural selection being slower amongst humans in comparison to other species. In this study, scientists have identified 6 main genetic clusters, and 5 of them correspond to major geographic regions, and subclusters that often correspond to individual populations. It also mentions that there is more genetic diversity within human populations than there is between them. In this study, 2 Caucasians are more similar to each other genetically than a Caucasian and an Asian. However, in a reanalysis of the data from 377 microsatellite loci, typed in 1,056 individuals, Europeans proved to be more similar to Asians than other Europeans 38% of the time. This is an example of humans from one population being more similar to members from another population. Self-racial identity is highly correlated with geographic ancestry, which is why race is not completely uninformative, and it does have predictive power. The genetic variation of humans is distributed as clines across geographic locations, so if you try to define a race on a genetic level, you're going to run into conflicting information, or someone else's definition of race on the genetic level will conflict with yours. The lines we draw may be discrete, but it's not discrete in nature. If you got one sample from a region in Africa, another from Europe, and another from Asia, it will look discrete, but it doesn't give you the full picture. You can use classifications for research purposes, but we must keep in mind of the overlapping nature of the genetic diversity of humanity. So studying the genetic variation using defined races will yield different results depending on the methodology being used. A human population is not necessarily used the same way as a race. Race involves grouping multiple human populations under a category. Now about forensic and physical anthropologists. How are they able to identify your race? The short answer is they aren't identifying your race. Anthropologists are using your DNA to trace your ancestry, and your ancestors come from a specific location where there are physical traits that are common to people in that location. Although they are fuzzy, anthropologists can identify these traits, and they can make a reasonable guess of a person's ancestry based on their remains. Anthropologists are just identifying the traits common in the location your ancestors originated from. What happens next is, based on your cultural perception of race, you pick the race that correlates to a person's ancestry. If your ancestors originated somewhere in Africa, you're going to be perceived as black, at least in America. How Americans perceive race will be different from how Brazilians perceive it. Most people group humans based on phenotypic markers, and those physical traits happen to be common in that specific location. So finding out where your ancestors originated from, you can identify those physical traits. Then you can attach a race to those traits. Forensic and physical anthropologists are not identifying your race. They are identifying your ancestry. Race comes afterwards. Another flaw in using race is it's used to make sweeping generalizations about multiple human populations in a way that limits its accuracy. Diseases have geographical origins. Sickle cell anemia is found almost exclusively in people of West African descent because of malaria. Due to the process of natural selection, nature selected for what was available to defend against malaria. Not all black people have sickle cell anemia. You could have had ancestors who didn't originate from West Africa. This is why geographic origins or lineage offer more of an explanation for these diseases than referring to race. Saying people of West African descent or live in West Africa are likely to have sickle cell anemia is much more accurate than saying black people are likely to have sickle cell anemia. If you were to refer to race, you're adding every human population that is considered to be black, and that weakens your predictive power. You can correlate a disease with race, but it correlates better with geographical origins or lineage. Race isn't an accurate representation of our genotype. In this source, it says, a final complication arises when racial classifications are used as proxies for geographic ancestry. Although many concepts of race are correlated with geographic ancestry, the two are not interchangeable, and relying on racial classifications will reduce predictive power still further. The fact that, given enough genetic data, individuals can be correctly assigned to their populations of origin is compatible with the observation that most human genetic variation is found within populations, not between them. It is also compatible with our finding that, even when the most distinct populations are considered and hundreds of loci are used, individuals are frequently more similar to members of other populations than to members of their own population. Thus, caution should be used when using geographic or genetic ancestry to make inferences about individual phenotypes. Baidu, which is marketed towards African Americans, is nothing more but a marketing gimmick. The main active ingredients are hydralazine and isosabide denitrate, and those two are used to treat heart failure in people from all races. This means Baidu's ingredients aren't new or made to help specifically African Americans. To be honest, the average person refers to race casually, meaning we group people based on phenotypic markers. The race realist claimed that race is all about genetics, but not necessarily. There are multiple ways people define a race. It could be skin color or class. Saying it's truly about genetics is very wrong, and it's a way to force a label of science on their position. When defining race on the phenotypic level, it's just as arbitrarily defined as on the genetic level. As our physical features get more ambiguous, we are just given a race, or we choose a race to identify as. Sometimes they are called mixed, and sometimes they pick a racial identity. If we had a mixed race category, it will hold more genetic diversity than the racial groups. Good luck trying to find out where to draw the line to consider someone mixed. You'll find out that it's more trouble than it's worth. To sum up humans in general, we are different, but we are one big family. These differences hold importance in some cases, but it's not useful in social settings. We should judge a person by the merits of their character, not by the differences they have no control over. If you can't find a peer-reviewed source to support what you're saying, and you find yourself trying to bend a source to fit your position, then perhaps you should reevaluate your position. I may have knowledge in this topic, but I would never claim to be an expert. Feel free to read my sources and verify them for yourself. Now about supposed innate intelligence differences. Certain race realists claim evolution is the cause of this because race is adapted to different environments. This requires an evolutionary explanation. Why innate intelligence was less adaptive for certain humans? Inferring this from the social aspects of a society is very flawed. I find that race realists like to ignore parts of history to suit their narrative, so I'll have to do research on the history of ancient African civilizations and make a video about what I found. For now, I quickly looked up the Society of Tassedi, also known as the Land of the Bow. While much of this society is currently unknown, we do know they were located along the border area towards Nubia. The Mali Empire, which was located in West Africa, was a big civilization. It thrived through its trading of gold, salt, and copper. They were able to build big buildings such as the Great Mosque of Djenne. This might be simplifying things, but what caused this collapse was after Mamut Keita IV died, none of his three sons took his place, resulting in the Mali Empire's eventual collapse. These are just two out of many, so I want to make a video fleshing out these two civilizations' story and talk about the others. It's going to be about history for the sake of history. No ideology will be attached to the video. The race realists rely on the cold winters theory to explain their position. They argue that the cold environments required more intelligence to live in them because you had to learn how to stay warm, build shelter, and find or grow food. These people are underestimating how extreme Africa is. The droughts destroyed a lot of their food resources, and the wildlife was much more dangerous, including the black mamba, crocodiles, lions, hippos, and mosquitoes. The constant human conflict didn't help much, either. The geographic region of Africa is much more hostile than Asia and Europe. It's misguided to say the lack of an advanced African society is a result of their genes. You're ignoring historical and environmental contexts, and there are way too many assumptions being made in this theory. For example, a race realist will say the African environment selected for physical attributes, which made them athletic. But that's just an assumption with no real study to back that up. I won't claim this is a fact, but a likely scenario is that the environment was too hostile for them to create many advanced civilizations, or because of too much human conflict. In my opinion, advanced societies are the result of a surplus of resources, so some of the people in the society had time to settle down and find ways to advance things using available resources. With a surplus of resources, your civilization will grow as a result and become more advanced. If your society never acquires a surplus of resources, then you're going to be focused on survival constantly. You probably won't have the time to tinker with your surroundings or come up with advanced technology. Just how Homo erectus and Homo ergaster were able to make tools in between hunts, because that downtime offered them enough free time to make them, or even think about how to make them in the first place. Imagine living in a society where you no longer have to go on long hunting trips in a nomadic fashion. Home is in one location and you have enough food to support everyone there. Now more people are moving from hunters to some other specialty. One thought leads to another, and over time you have an advanced society, assuming nothing terrible prevents this process. Also, if your environment doesn't offer you much to manipulate, then you most likely won't go very far in regards to technology. I brought up Eskimos as a way to poke a hole in the cold winters theory, but the race realists have added agriculture to the cold environments to make it work. So now you must explain what about agriculture causes higher intelligence that cold environments alone was missing. The Africans had agriculture, so adding this condition to this theory doesn't really help you. Once again, the cold winters theory is pretty much a way to infer the selective pressures of thousands of years ago using cherry-picked historical and environmental contexts. Feel free to speculate, but don't state your opinion as fact. The next topic in intelligence is how they draw a causation from correlation. It's just as flawed as feminists looking at the correlation of average income between men and women and then drawing a causation from it. Women are just paid less than men. Race realists say black people score low on average on IQ tests because of their genes. The data doesn't mention any correlation to any genes. The only correlation is race and IQ. That's it. The data can't be used to draw genetic causalities because of potential confounding variables. I do not dispute the data shown in these statistics. I agree with the data. Statistics don't lie, but the people who use and make them can. Just because I arrived at a different conclusion than you, it doesn't mean I'm denying the data. I like my Bible example, so I'm using it again. Look at these statistics as if they were verses in a Bible. There are multiple interpretations of the same source. I'm what you would call a statistics fundamentalist in this analogy. I only agree with what's exactly shown in the statistics, and I don't assume anything beyond what's shown in the data. There are statistics with manipulated data to push a narrative, but I'm keeping things simple. Race realist interprets these statistics to fit their worldview, like a homosexual Christian who interprets the Bible in a way to say God accepts homosexual people when the Bible clearly doesn't. they interpret the statistics in such a way to make it seem as if the data supports a genetic causality. As you can see, there are multiple interpretations of the same source. Fortunately, only one interpretation is right, the statistics fundamentalist. When trying to be objective, be the statistics fundamentalist. Don't assume more than what the data shows. The next argument is the average different brain sizes of each race. Once again, I'm skeptical on the data, but even if they are true, they shouldn't be used to say East Asians are the smartest because they have the biggest brain. Brain size and intelligence are positively correlated, but scientists caution people from making the oversimplified assertion that brain size determines intelligence. Studies show that brain structure is much more efficient in determining how the brain contributes to intelligence than saying brain size determines intelligence. If that were the case, Neanderthals, elephants, whales, and dolphins should be more intelligent than us humans. Their brains are bigger than ours. Even if you want to say a bigger body caused their brain to be bigger, then the Neanderthals pokes a hole in that. They had a bigger brain despite them being shorter than us. Neanderthals were intelligent, but they weren't as intelligent as humans. In this source it says, for humans, the statistical relationship is modest but significant. Obviously, the finding is only correlational. Greater brain size may cause greater intelligence. Greater intelligence may cause greater brain size, or both may be dependent on some third factor. Moreover, how effectively the brain is used is probably more important than its size. For example, on average, men have larger brains than women, but women have better connections through the corpus callosum between the two hemispheres. So it's not clear which sex have, on average, an advantage, probably neither. The reason why I'm skeptical on the average brain size between the races is because many of the race realists who do research on this subject have flawed methods. Richard Lind and J. Philip P. Rushton have flawed research. I'm not sure if they purposely sought after smaller brain sizes for Africans or not. Richard Lind has been caught purposefully seeking Africans with low IQs and ignoring Africans with high IQs. In this source, Richards and his colleagues examined over 100 published studies, concluding that there is no evidence to back up Lind's claims. Amongst other flaws, Lind used selective data by systematically ignoring Africans with high IQ scores. The researchers also claimed that African IQ test scores cannot be interpreted in terms of lower intelligence levels, as these scores have different psychometric characteristics than Western IQ test scores. Until now, the incomparability of Western and African IQ scores has never been systematically proven. The scientists point out that the average African IQ is currently comparable to the average level in the Netherlands around 1950. However, IQ scores in Western countries has risen sharply over the course of the 20th century. In view of this trend, Richards and his colleagues claim that there are no reasonable grounds to conclude that sub-Saharan countries are poor due to lower IQ scores of their populations. As it turns out, the average IQ of African adults is seeing a similar rising trend, which is expected to continue if living conditions in Africa improve in the future. They say that's because many race realists say Africans are poor because of low IQ instead of the other way around. So there is great genetic diversity in Africa, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think they let us know where in Africa did they collect their brain size samples. Where in Europe did they collect their samples? All I saw were average brain sizes of Africans and Europeans, with no mention of where in these two continents did they collect these samples. If Lind is capable of selecting data to fit his conclusions, this makes me highly skeptical of other race realists. Once again, here's your chance to link sources to inform me where did these samples come from. There is also conflicting data. Race realists will show you this from Rushton. Black people have an average brain size of 1,267 cubic centimeters, and white people have an average brain size of 1,347 cubic centimeters. There has to be some extreme generalizations going on here if he's implying that there are only three races. In a source that you have to buy, the average brain size of Europeans is lower than this. The average brain size of Europeans is 1,260 cubic centimeters for men and 1,130 cubic centimeters for women. That is about the same average brain size as black people. In another source that you have to pay for, had an average brain size of 1,273.6 cubic centimeters for people mainly of European descent. Once again, pretty close to the average brain size of black people that Rushton gave us. However, there was variation ranging from 1,052.9 to 1,498.5 cubic centimeters for men and 974.9 to 1,398.1 cubic centimeters for women. Once again, these numbers are on Wikipedia, but if you want to verify these numbers for yourself, you can buy access to the sources they are based on. The links are in the description box. If there is variation in brain sizes for Europeans, then most likely there is variation in brain sizes for Africans. Not necessarily, of course, but I have a good reason to believe this because there is great genetic diversity in Africa. So where did these samples come from? For East Asians, they let you know what region in Asia they are getting their samples. The name is self-evident. I'm quite sure the average brain size for Asians will go down if you include Asians from other parts of the region. If you're focused on specific regions on a continent, then you're going to get the results you want to get. I'm not sold on the results until more research is done. This is a source for IQ comparisons. We doubt strongly whether IQ tests have the same substantive meaning across the globe. Templer claimed that the construct validity of national IQs is supported by their correlation with means in national scholastic achievement surveys. However, such ecological correlations do not warrant conclusions concerning the measurement and variance of IQ tests across national groups. For instance, national IQs correlate about 0.85 with fertility rate, but this doesn't mean that IQs could be taken to measure the number of offspring of individuals. It's completely unclear whether national IQs reflect differences between contemporary populations in terms of the average level of G. Because the Flynn effect doesn't appear to be explainable in terms of G, it is even doubtful whether the current day IQ levels of populations reflect the average level of G of these populations a couple decades ago. Because the content of IQ tests is typically from the 20th century, it is even more doubtful that the national IQs can be projected back to our ancestors who lived 5,000 years ago. That means making conclusions from the comparisons of IQ differences across countries and civilizations from the past to present is flawed. This is based on Russians' brain size data that I showed previously. The mean difference may appear impressive, but it is virtually meaningless without knowledge of the typical spread of brain size within populations, which is around standard deviation 130 cubic centimeters. So the black-white difference in brain size is approximately 0.6 standard deviation units. Russians' figures are based not on contemporary MRI measurements of white and gray matter volume, but rather on outdated external or post-mortem cranial measurements. Even if cranial capacity had a casual effect on G, the black-white gap in brain size that Rushton gave us can't explain more than 1.8 IQ points. This means explaining the IQ gap using the brain size that Rushton gave us would leave 95% unexplained. Even if we take Rushton's data as true, there's a lot missing here. You can read more in the description box. So, intelligence is a complex trait, which means it's influenced by genetic and environmental factors. Intelligence is hard to study because it can be defined and measured in different ways. Intelligence in this context means innate intelligence. Elements of intelligence include the ability to plan, reason, solve problems, think abstractly, and understand complex ideas. This is internal and education is external. Education that is provided to you by a teacher, tutor, mentor, or a parent can help develop your innate intelligence. Education deals with knowledge. With education and training, you can develop your intelligence, but without education, the abilities that lie within you will be latent. If you can develop your intelligence with education, you can increase your IQ. Yes, IQ doesn't measure human intelligence in its entirety, but what it does measure for is accurate. Saying IQ tests accurately measure intelligence in its entirety is oversimplifying a broad term such as intelligence. You can't quantify intelligence with a single number. While psychometricians believe G-loaded tests reflect a test taker's innate intelligence, others argue that, while there may or may not be a general intelligence factor, performance on tests rely crucially on knowledge acquired through prior exposure to the types of tasks that such tests contain. This view would mean that tests can't be expected to reflect only the innate abilities of a given individual, because the expression of potential will always be mediated by experience and cognitive habits. It also means that comparison of test scores from persons with widely different life experiences and cognitive habits is not an expression of their relative innate potentials. This is more understandable because the average black person in America have a very different learning experience than the average white person. These studies suggest that genetic factors underlie about 50% of the difference in intelligence among individuals, which I believe they are talking about heritability of IQ, and I'll explain what that means later on. So, genes in the environment influence intelligence. The studies also didn't conclusively identify the genes that are involved in intelligence. Most likely, there are a large number of genes involved, and each of them only make a small contribution of a person's intelligence. Of course, the small contributions add up, if there are a large number of genes. Without the ability to identify these genes, none of us can jump to conclusions about these genes. I still don't expect there to be this significant gap in innate intelligence between the races because overall we are genetically similar, and yes, this is me speculating. Intelligence is influenced by nature and nurture, and IQ tests are not accurate measurements of human intelligence in its entirety. Now I want to talk about the black-white IQ gap. First of all, socioeconomic status is definitely a variable in a gap, but it's not the only variable. Race realists will try to debunk socioeconomic status as a variable in a gap, but I have sources to explain why it's definitely a variable involved. Black people on average still receive poor education and are still, on average, less wealthy than white people today. It's not the result of low IQ. Low IQ is still influenced by low socioeconomic status, because the wealthier you are, the better learning environment you can afford. This source will explain that black people on average don't receive the same opportunities as white people on average. Upward mobility from the bottom of the income distribution is less likely for black Americans than white Americans. 51% of black Americans born into the lowest fifth of the earning distribution remain there at age 40. Downward intergenerational social mobility from the middle to the bottom is much more common among black Americans. The source also mentions that black people are not as wealthy as white people on average, that most black families with children are headed by a single parent, and many black students attend the worst schools. These factors play a role in the IQ gap. Many race realists try to make the actions of the white racist in the past seem insignificant, basically trying to shift the entire blame on black people. That black people are poor because they are black. That is disingenuous. You're basically ignoring the historical context of racism in America. The racism in the past set many black people back financially by a lot, and a lot of the problems that black people face are multi-generational problems. If Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma wasn't burned down by white racists, I'm quite sure many more black people would be wealthy today. Black Wall Street was a thriving community of predominantly black people. Black people were recovering after slavery during the Reconstruction era, but racist white people stopped their recovery and sent them back to where they started. The problems caused by racism doesn't go away just because the segregation era ended. If a black family don't have many opportunities throughout their lives and are not able to move up in life, you're saying it's because of their genes? This is just an intellectually lazy way to support genetic determinism, so you can use this as a reason to justify white nationalism. Just because black people are no longer systematically oppressed, it doesn't mean black people are suddenly warped to equal financial footing to white people. Certain people don't have access to higher education. It's a mix of circumstance and personal desire. If their environments improve, so will their IQ. Saying black people are poor because of their genes is not supported. I agree that there is no systematic racism that is keeping black people down today, but to imply the actions of the white racist people had little to no effect on black people's current circumstance is not true. As of now, America's classist system is what's keeping black people down, along with their own poor decisions due to their circumstance. Another variable involved in the IQ gap is personal desire for higher education. Without proper education, you won't use your innate intelligence at its greatest potential. Unfortunately, many black people in America adhere to anti-intellectual teachings and associate themselves with counterproductive people. The culture many black people associate themselves with is not optimal for producing great intellectuals. The anti-intellectualism, being peer pressure to fit within a mold, not taking education seriously, making poor life decisions, and other very toxic social problems. If you constantly have problems that you're trying to fix because of your poor decisions, then education will not be a priority. Once again, these are multi-generational problems and they influence the next generation's decisions. Some are able to change their circumstances, but many are not. This isn't the result of their genes because it doesn't explain those who started off with one or more of these problems, but then they changed their lives for the better. That is why genetic determinism in regards to culture is flawed. How can black people begin to take responsibility for their own actions if you think their actions are dictated by genes? You're basically replacing the left's, "It's not your fault, it's because of racism," with your, "It's not your fault, it's because of your genes." Each race is varied and diverse, and you're relying on stereotypes to infer a genetic causality, and that is not logically sound. Culture is simply the accumulation of values, ideas, and morals. Saying culture is the direct result of race or genes is an unfounded assertion. Culture is not bound by race. If that was the case, I should be incapable of identifying with certain elements of other people's culture, and I should be incapable of not associating myself with the culture many black people associate themselves with. Please list a source that says otherwise. Saying behavior is mainly the result of genes ignores the complex interaction with your biology, societal expectations, the environment, and your morality. Another variable that can affect the black-white IQ gap is health. All of these environmental factors have a constant complex relationship with each other. Race realists are quick to show the correlations between income, IQ or SAT scores, and race to show that the gaps still remain. As you can see, the gap closes a little because income is definitely a variable involved, but it's not the only one. Statistics never tell you the full story. I'm including this argument from the alternative hypothesis to show just how misleading they can be. The alternative hypothesis compared the GDP per capita of black people and their IQ with other countries. In this example, per capita GDP is focused on black people in America. This is supposed to show black people are wealthier than people in these other countries, yet they have a lower IQ than them. Therefore, genes play a role in the gap. People like him never seem to factor in the cost of living in these other countries. He used the statistics I just showed you to say, the people in these countries are less wealthy than African Americans, yet they are smarter. Therefore, this disproves socioeconomic status as a factor in the IQ gap. Socioeconomic status is a factor in the IQ gap, but not the entire reason why in America. Black people are wealthier than people in the countries listed because they live in a country with a higher cost of living. None of the countries listed have a higher cost of living than America, which means you need more money to live in America than those other countries. Black people earn enough to get by on average, but it's hardly considered wealthy by American standards. This comparison is absurd. It doesn't matter if black people have a higher GDP per capita than people in another country. What matters is if the income they make in America is enough to meet the standards of living, afford proper education, live in positive learning environments, and much more in America. The people in other countries probably don't need the amount of GDP per capita that black people have to have a higher IQ. Being less wealthy and having around 100 IQ points can coexist if you have a proper learning environment. Their lower GDP per capita could afford a proper learning environment in their own country, but they wouldn't be able to do so if they moved to America with their current GDP per capita. Of course, other factors such as taking education seriously helps as well. The rest of the person's arguments have been covered or about to be covered in this video. I also find it a bit unfair that they are comparing black people, who are a subgroup of people living in America, to the average GDP per capita and IQ of an entire country. Black people by American standards are not that wealthy on average. I hope you understand that comparing a group of people who are at the lower end of the income spectrum in America to the average of an entire country is a flawed comparison. A better comparison would be to compare the poorer people within each of these countries instead of the entire country as if black people are representative of the average GDP per capita and IQ of America. Even though this would have been fairer, you still have the problem of different learning environments. They want to say the IQ gap is mainly the result of genes, but we currently don't know. We can't use statistical data to infer genetic causalities or imply they disprove the environmental factors. I disagree with saying only environmental factors play a role in intelligence, because evidence points to genetic factors also playing a role in intelligence. We just haven't discovered them, and we don't know if they differ between the races. We also don't know if the environmental factors explain the entire gap, but it might explain the majority of it given my earlier source. They try to explain crime with monoamine oxidase A and higher testosterone, and they often never mention the environmental or social factors involved in criminality. When it comes to our behavior, genes don't work in absolutes. Genetics do play an important role in violent behavior, but scientists warned against labeling monoamine oxidase A and CDH13 as crime genes. The majority of people who carry these genes do not commit violent crimes, and the increased risk associated with the genes is small. Brett Haberstick of the University of Colorado boldly stresses that there are many factors, not just genes, that can lead someone to exhibit violence. No matter how hard you try to deflect this, the claim that genes are the main cause of crime or why black people commit more crime is unsubstantiated. Looking at the statistics, black people do commit a disproportionate amount of crime compared to white people, but the statistics don't give you the entire story. You'd have to ignore the average black person's circumstance and environment in order to say it's mainly due to genes. This is just lazy thinking. Now I'm going to talk about whether or not the IQ gap is closing. It depends on who you want to agree with. If you agree with Charles Murray, you're going to say the gap is not closing, and if you agree with James Flynn, you're going to say the gap is closing, but slowly. Due to the fact that there is inconclusive evidence on this subject, neither one of them debunked the possibility of the other person being right. So it depends on where your biases lie. Everyone, including me, have biases, but we must remove our biases as much as possible and interpret every source objectively as possible. Here are IQ scores based on the National Assessment of Educational Progress from 1978 to 2012. The age group are 17-year-olds. Black people in 1978 had an IQ of 81.46, and they had an IQ of 91.14 in 2012. This shows a closing of the IQ gap over time, but the gap still remains. Here's an optimistic outcome based on predictions up to 2060. Black people may have an IQ average of 98.5. Here's a pessimistic outcome based on predictions up to 2060. Black people may have an IQ average of 95.88. In both predictions, the average IQ of black people is increasing slowly but surely. If this is true, genetics can't explain this because evolution doesn't work this fast in humans because of our slower sexual maturity rates. Also, the average IQ of black people is increasing faster than the average IQ of white people. Perhaps the environmental factors I previously mentioned are slowly improving. Not all of them, but the right ones that affect intelligence the most. I personally am not sure if the data provided by the National Assessment of Educational Progress is reliable, but if it is, then this is good news for black people. I have another source that says the racial gap is decreasing. It is often asserted that black Americans had made no IQ gains on white Americans. Until recently, there had been no adequate data to measure trends in black IQ. We analyzed data from 9 standardization samples for 4 major tests of cognitive ability. These data suggest that blacks gained 4-7 IQ points on non-Hispanic whites between 1972 and 2002. Gains have been fairly uniform across the entire range of black cognitive ability. Although the numbers are a bit different in this source, because I believe there are multiple ways of calculating IQ, these sources show a decrease in the black-white IQ gap. Wherever your biases lie will determine which scenario you want to follow. However way Charles Murray calculated the IQ of people led him to believe the IQ gap is not closing anymore, and however way James Flynn calculated the IQ of people led him to believe the IQ gap is closing slowly. You can't say there's no evidence that the gap is decreasing. I'm going to quickly talk about the alternative hypothesis perspective on the National Assessment of Educational Progress source. He says the NAEP tests were designed to have a standard deviation of 35, and since IQ tests have a standard deviation of 15, he's going to convert the scores into NAEP IQ scores. By setting the white score to 100 and converting the other races' scores to IQ based on the standard deviation of 15. The problem here is that he doesn't give you the formula he used to convert the NAEP scores into IQ scores, so people can verify it for themselves. He says he can convert the scores to a scale where the mean and median is 100 and has a standard deviation of 15. You can do that, but it's unnecessary. By doing this, you're not creating data that's equivalent to IQ scores. You're just mimicking the presentation of the statistics. You're better off going by the numbers they gave you, otherwise you risk distorting the original values. The source I used actually show you how they converted the NAEP scores into IQ scores. For all we know, you could have skewed the results into your favor because the numbers they gave us are higher than the numbers you gave us. He says you could take 40-yard dash times, find the standard deviation of the times, and then come up with a 40-yard dash IQ? What? No, dude. At best, you're talking about means, modes, and medians with standard deviations. While IQ statistics are presented that way, it's a whole different story when it comes to actually calculating the scores themselves. Please explain how you can convert timestamps into IQ scores without taking into account of the methodology used to determine your IQ. Relax, I'm teasing you. I'm sure you didn't mean they can be converted into IQ scores. I hope. What can settle this easily is if you show us your work. How did you convert the NAEP scores into IQ scores? What formula did you use? I'm very certain it wasn't as complex as this one. So he shows us his NAEP IQ scores, which I'm very skeptical of. So even after he played with the numbers, he still couldn't get rid of this closing gap trend that the original source shows. His first explanation is that funding is often tied to the scores. Black schools fudge exclude a large proportion of their students from the test. I looked through his sources to find the one about the exclusion, and it says there is academic fraud going on, which excludes students from the NAEP exam. So his claim is that this is going on in black schools, so let's see if that checks out. The first problem is, this source doesn't say anything specific about schools with predominantly black students. It just lists exclusion rates based on various cities. Dallas has an exclusion rate of 44%, and there are more white people living in Dallas than black people, so this is hardly a black school problem. This is a problem in schools in general. The second and biggest problem is, you failed to mention that this is about students in special education and English language learner programs, not students in general. Why did you make this source out to be something it's not? Your second explanation for the closing gap is that students in low-performing urban school districts would cheat. I clicked the source you used to support yourself, and once again, this is about students in special education and ELL programs. It also says cheating the NAEP, not cheating on the NAEP. The source isn't about the students, but rather the schools. I'm not trying to be mean here, but this is clear-cut confirmation bias and misinterpretation of sources. You didn't even read these sources because your blog site doesn't mention anything about special education and ELL programs. Feel free to explain yourself if you choose to respond to my video, like you do other people. If you want to read his article and the two sources of his that I've covered, the links are in the description box. Now I want to talk about heritability. The race and intelligence supporters among the race realists will bring up heritability and intelligence to explain that the IQ scores are there because of genetics. Many of them use heritability incorrectly. The common misconception is that people think a heritability of a trait means that's how much influence genetics have on that trait in the individual. That is not true. Heritability is the proportion of the total variation between individuals in a population due to genetic variation. The key word here is variation. The number does not apply to individuals, and the number is not fixed. Different populations that are being observed or measured can have different percentages of heritability for a trait. So saying a trait has a heritability of 75% does not mean 75% of that trait is due to genes in an individual. Heritability is the measurement of variation. If a population is in an identical environment, this means that whatever variation exists between the organisms must be the result of genes alone. The environment exerts an identical influence on all of the organisms in a population. In this example, heritability is 1 or 100%. If the organisms are genetically identical but we put them in various environments, this means any variation that exists between them is not due to genes. This means the variation is caused by the environment alone, so heritability is 0 or 0% in this example. I cannot stress this enough that heritability is different from inherited. Just because someone say that the heritability of IQ of a population is 80%, it does not mean they inherited 80% of their IQ from their parents. I'm going to give an example of heritability. In this population, the heritability for height is 75% or 0.75. This means that 75% of variation of height among individuals in this population is due to genetic variation. From the shortest person to the tallest person in this population, 75% of variation of this trait is due to genetic variation, and 25% is due to environmental variation. This does not mean height is 75% genetic. This means 75% of the variation in height from short to tall in this population is due to genetic variation. Remember, heritability never refers to an individual, so high heritability means that genetic variation explains more of the variation in a trait than the environment, and low heritability means that more environmental influences are impacting the variation. No trait is ever 100% heritable. Genetics and the environment will always play a role in variation in a trait. This next bit of information is about variation in IQ in humans. Heritability for intelligence starts at 20% in infants and rises to 40% in teenagers, to 60% in adults, and rises further in 80% in later adulthood. After the age of 80, heritability for intelligence decreases to about 60%. An explanation of this is that people with different genes tend to seek out different environments that reinforce the effects of these genes. The heritability of intelligence increases during development despite strong genetic stability from age to age. This increasing heritability in intelligence despite genetic stability is called genetic amplification. We basically select learning environments that maximize genetic influences as we age. In this study, children who are disadvantaged don't have access to high-quality opportunities, such as learning resources and parental involvement, and this means they can't reach their genetic potential. Genetic influences on cognitive ability are maximized when people are free to select their own learning experiences. Tucker Drop also says we are born with blueprints. The question is, how are we using our experiences to build upon our genetic makeup? That's similar to my position. I believe we all have a similar genetic base for intelligence, but the environment will determine whether or not we'll use our genetic base for intelligence at its highest potential. In general, heritability of intelligence increases with age, but that might not be true for everyone. You're going to have those who are not able to maximize their genetic potential because they live in disadvantaged learning environments. Since a lot of black children live in disadvantaged learning environments, they will have a hard time reaching their genetic potential for intelligence. This does not mean no black person can overcome this, but it's harder to do so than those in advantaged learning environments. Heritability estimates only apply to groups on which estimates are based. Even if heritability of IQ is high, heredity does not necessarily account for differences between groups. Once again, heritability is different from inherited. Now I'm going to talk about twin studies. The classical twin study design relies on studying twins raised in the same family environments. Monozygotic or identical twins share all of their genes, and dizygotic or fraternal twins share only about 50% of their genes. So if a researcher compares the similarity between sets of identical twins to the similarity between sets of fraternal twins for a particular trait, then any sex likeness between the identical twins should be due to genes rather than the environment. Researchers use this method and variations on it to estimate the heritability of traits. So in this study, 4,672 monozygotic twin pairs had an 86% heritability for intelligence, and 5,546 dizygotic twin pairs had a 60% heritability for intelligence. Do you see how the numbers change depending on the population being measured? Since a monozygotic pair of twins share all of their genes, and genetic variation explains 86% of heritability of intelligence among the total monozygotic twin pairs, people conclude that variation in IQ between individuals in a population is largely due to genetic variation. For example, the black-white IQ gap is due to genetic differences between black and white people, but this article explains that that's the wrong perception to have with this data. It says that the large heritability for intelligence can be controversial because of the perceived implications that a person's or group's intelligence can't be changed by intervention strategies. The article says that this is the incorrect perception. On another page of the same source, it is explained that a large increase in the mean of IQ has been observed in numerous populations. This is called the Flynn effect. The problem with saying the increase of the mean of IQ shouldn't happen if IQ is highly heritable is that heritability should not be used to make predictions about mean changes in the population over time or about differences between groups, because in each individual calculation, the heritability is defined for a particular population and says nothing about environments in other populations. The heritability of a trait in one population being observed or measured can be different from other populations. This is why using twin studies to explain the black-white IQ gap is flawed. Race realists are using heritability incorrectly, and heritability is different from inherited. Sure, black people may not be using their genetic base for intelligence at its highest potential, but we don't know if that genetic base is the same for everyone. If you want to see my response to Laughing Mano X, then you can watch part 5 of my previous Race Realism Debunked video. It's about to be a year since that video, so I'm not expecting him to reply. He most likely chose to ignore it because the evidence is very strong that he wasn't being honest in his video. Whether or not it was intentional is arguable, but no one can deny the errors there. Now I'm going to talk about the application of race realism. If race realism is proven to be true, what do we do with that truth without making ourselves look prejudiced? Statistical averages tell you nothing about me as an individual, and I don't care about IQ to take an IQ test. I never committed a violent crime, but would you have known that if you saw me walking past you with your race realist mindset? What kind of policies would you put in place using this information that wouldn't be unethical? If you really think about it, race realism doesn't have a practical real-world application that wouldn't have severe consequences. It's just fuel for racist ideologies, and most of you never talk about using this information to help people. I'm starting to believe many of you embrace the racist implications of race realism because of how certain left-winged people alienated you. This perceived anti-white narrative being perpetuated is a big selling point. Somewhere underneath this lies genuine concerns that you believe no one wants to address. I get it. The extreme left-wing narrative has excluded straight white men. The left-wing identity politics has become toxic, and you believe that white nationalism is a way to counter it. You've seen the statistics and believe non-white people will replace white people as the majority. With race realism, you believe all of the things you enjoy about Western civilization will die when white people are no longer the majority. You believe this kind of civilization can only be maintained by white people. You also believe left-wing people are ignoring crime statistics from minorities and immigrants, so this means nothing will be done about it. This kicked in this survival instinct within you, and it's led you to think this way. But I'm going to tell you that you're going about this the wrong way. There are ways to oppose the extremist left-wing narrative without becoming an extremist yourself, and current statistics are not set in stone predictors of population trends. Anything can happen in the future. There are also ways to bring up crime statistics and the problems with mass immigration without sounding racist. Don't just bring these things up and then talk about separation. Talk about ways to mitigate the problem in the most ethical way possible. Do research on reasonable intervention strategies and effective immigration policies to come to an informed conclusion. Trying to explain crime and the problems with black and brown people using race realism will not work out in the long run. You're going to gain a following right now because many people are burnt out by the extreme left, but I'm certain that if things improve and the left-wing extremism isn't as prevalent as it is now, people are going to drop race realism. You can't do anything with it. Years from now, you're going to look back on today and say what a waste of time this was, depending on how deeply involved you were with it today. I believe the white people who felt alienated by the extreme left-wing narrative jumped to white nationalism because it's the only thing wanting to hear them out. After talking to some right-leaning people, one of them being Master Shadow Ninja, I don't think people just woke up one day to be racist. White nationalism didn't get popular because people think it's cool to be racist now. They wanted a place to voice their concerns without being called a bigot by left-leaning people. It doesn't help by being the racist they think you are, which gives them ammo to call you racist even more. As a result of this, you make their message stronger and legitimate. You become something they can point to support themselves. You're going about this all wrong. The left-leaning people who just call you all racist are just reacting to the reaction to a problem. This in return will make white nationalists stronger and justifiable because these left-leaning people aren't addressing why they resorted to white nationalism. Both sides are just fueling each other at this point, and the discourse that follows lacks any bit of nuance. I don't agree with racial nationalism or race realism, but I can understand why they may turn to it. My solution to white nationalism is to hear them out, and perhaps this will push them out of the extreme ideologies. Realizing that they do have a voice in left-wing dominant discourse, they will feel more at home outside of white nationalism. This also could apply to the extreme left. I think an open discourse and compromise is the answer to healing this fractured country, but many people choose not to listen to the other side. We all like to think we're right, but try listening for once. If you still happen to disagree, then there's no reason why a disagreement has to lead to incivility. Sure, there are hardcore racists who seriously believe this pseudoscience. I don't want people to think I'm saying every white nationalist was pushed to the extreme by the left, because white nationalists existed way before the term SJW became a thing. Just saying the left caused this lacks nuance. The extreme left-wing narrative is a big contributing factor in their growth, but it doesn't explain everything and it's not the only reason why they would become white nationalists. I also don't want people to think I'm implying that the extremists on the left are representative of everyone on the left. For the white nationalists who are genuinely racist, I respect your right to believe whatever you want, but I won't take you seriously if all you have to offer is edgelord statements and copy-paste comments as a rebuttal. There will be white nationalists who may not ever change their mind and they are lost in racist rhetoric. They've justified their viewpoint beyond the range of questioning it. If you happen to encounter these people, I will understand you moving on and not wanting to deal with them. No one wants to deal with an ideologue who showed no signs of considering the opposing viewpoint. If they call you some buzzword while you're trying to address their arguments, just dismiss them. It's not worth your time to continue at that point. I might do more replying to race realists, but I'll give it a more lighthearted tone, because I want to mitigate the heavy tension this topic can bring. It can get intimidating because the sources that race realists use are not completely wrong. They are using the truth but accompanied it with lies to reach an extreme conclusion. The key to bringing race realists to a halt is not to let them control the truth. The crime and IQ statistics are legitimate. You can create racial categories based on the genetic diversity of humanity despite its limitations and flaws. These limitations and flaws often lead biologists to argue against using them for scientific research. Everything else is race realist ignoring historical and environmental context and refusing to learn from peer-reviewed sources about race and biology. I also catch them misinterpreting their own sources, which I believe is due to confirmation bias. Just ask them to cite their sources and read them carefully yourself. More times than not, the source isn't saying what they think it's saying. Read the researcher's discussion or notes about their research. Understand the limitations of what the research can't be used to support. I believe them being ideologically driven, usually for white nationalism, is the source of their problem. White nationalism needs race realism for people to take it seriously. Being wrong is not an option for them. It gives them a reason why they shouldn't be replaced by non-whites. In my opinion, white nationalism is an emotional reactionary response, and race realism is an extension of that. I know there are race realists from other races. The way black race realists talk about other black people in their videos will make the most racist white person blush. Seriously, if I'm getting called an Uncle Tom, Coon, and Sambo, I can't wait to see what pro-blacks would call a black race realist. This video is for those who are on the fence on this subject, or for race realists who do want to consider opposing arguments. You don't have to agree with me, but please listen. As always, I don't wish harm on race realists, and I hope a more calmer and less ranty video will help more of them listen to me. If not, you can't say I didn't try to be reasonable with them. If you have a disagreement, please be mature about it and let me know. I am not infallible. Anyways, thanks for watching and take care.